Good evening, everyone. It is so wonderful to see you guys come out so we can praise the Lord together, hear his word, and just give all the praise, honor, and glory to our Lord, singing Christmas carols, and it's just amazing. Just want to just say thank you, Lord Jesus. Everyone will stay seated during the praise and honoring of the Lord. Praise God. But we can sing together. Praise God. What hope we hold this starlit night? A king is born in Bethlehem. Our journey long, we seek the light that leads to the Halloween manger ground. What fear we felt in the silent age, 400 years can he be found, but broken by a baby's cry, rejoice in the Halloween manger. Thank you.
Amen. Well, welcome tonight, our candlelight service and observing the Lord's Supper. Thank you again for being here. We have such a great reason to celebrate, and again, I'm glad you're here to do that with us. And I just want to encourage you tonight to definitely enjoy the carols, but let's take this moment to really worship God and to give Him our all in this moment. Such a special time for the body to come together and observe the Lord's Supper. And so, again, I encourage you to take advantage of this opportunity. Let's pray. Ask God's blessing on the offering. Father, we come before you and thank you so much, Lord, that you saw fit again to come to this earth clothed in flesh. Lord, to die in our place. Lord, a death that we all deserve, God. And we thank you for that, Lord. We thank you for this freedom that we have to worship you and to thank you. Lord, this, again, this special time of year that we've set aside to celebrate this. God, we just stand in awe of who you are. And we're so thankful for what you've done. And Lord, at this time, Lord, as we take this offering, I pray that you would, Lord, bless this part of the worship. Lord, an expression of praise, an expression of thanksgiving to give back to you. A portion of what you've blessed us with. Lord, that your kingdom would be furthered. We know that you don't need money. We know that you don't need anything that we can give to you. But God, it's a part of your plan. And we ask that you would bless it and use it to glorify yourself and further your kingdom. We also ask that you bless the rest of this service. Your hand would be honored all, Lord. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Voices, oh, now. Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Come, you will conceive in your womb and give birth to a son, and you will call his name Jesus.
How can this be, since I've been with no man?
The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power from the Most High will overshadow you. And the holy offspring shall be called the Son of God. Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Come, you will conceive in your womb and give birth to a son, and you will call his name Jesus.
How can this be, since I've been with no man?
The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power from the Most High will overshadow you. And the holy offspring shall be called the Son of God.
Teenage girl, much too young, unprepared for what's to come. A baby changes everything. Touched, how will she keep his trust? A baby changes everything. A baby changes everything. And she cries. Changes everything, and she cries, and she cries, oh, she cries. Shepherds all, they gather. Shines down. angels sing, glory to newborn King. Baby changes everything. A baby changes everything. Everything, everything. A baby changes everything.
Amen. Good. Yep. All kinds of stuff tonight. Oh, praise the Lord. There we go. Amen. Well, again, I'm excited that you're here tonight, and
we're going to talk about Emmanuel,
the bread of life tonight. And before we begin, I first want to exhort you to take this time to make sure that there's nothing in your heart towards another person. If you've got aught against someone, unforgiveness in your heart, now would be the time to take care of that before we get into the Lord's Supper. It's a time to examine, time to evaluate what's going on in your life. And so I want to encourage you to do that at this time. But the second thing is this. Participation in the Lord's Supper tonight is only for born-again believers in Jesus Christ. And so if you've never placed your faith, if you haven't been obedient, in baptism, we want to encourage you to just withhold from participating tonight. On Sunday, we looked at the profoundness of God coming in the form of his own creation. It's the idea that the Creator came in the form of his own creation. This evening, again, as we partake in the Lord's Supper, in remembrance of why he came and again what he came to do, we're going to look at that more in depth on Sunday. But I want to look at another profound angle of God coming to earth. Again, it's a basic thing. It's something simple. But again, it's just absolutely profound. So I want to pray and get into that tonight. So, Father, we come before you. We come before you just so thankful again. And I pray that tonight as we look at observing the Lord's Supper, and as we do observe it, Lord, that Lord, we would take this moment to really meditate on what you've done, to really, above that, consider who you are and meditate on that, Lord. Lord, we're just so thankful that we get to do this freely. God, as I was praying today, our brothers and sisters around the world that are persecuted, they don't have this blessing that we have right now, just freely. Remembering the broken body and the shed blood. God, we're just so thankful. And while we're thankful, Lord, we also want to lift up our brothers and sisters around the world, Lord, that they would be strengthened, that those that are persecuted and imprisoned, those that don't have this freedom, maybe those that are celebrating in their hearts and Lord, giving their lives to do that, Lord. I pray, again, that you'd comfort them. Lord, that you would just bless this time now. Lord, just let me speak the words that you have. And we pray that you'd be honored in it all. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I didn't send any scriptures to the guys in the back, and I apologize for that, but I was not exactly sure what I was going to cover as far as what scriptures I was going to cover and what I was going to leave out. And so, if you have your Bibles, I encourage you to turn to Hebrews chapter 11 first. Verse 3, it says, through faith we understand that the world, and that's talking about the universe essentially, both our earth and everything basically contained within the universe, were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. So the earth, everything in it, everything in the universe was not made by things that you and I can see. Again, it was framed, it was formed, it was created by God speaking it into existence, forming it with his hands. So I want to go back and look at that, look at a couple of scriptures. Again, we did this Sunday. I want to look at it again tonight in Genesis chapter 1. You can flip there if you want to. I know they'll probably get it up there pretty quick. In verse 1, you know it, very, very familiar scripture. It says this, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. God created the heaven and the earth. If we skip down to verse 9, it says this, and God said, again, his word, he said, let the waters under the heaven be gathered together in one place. And listen to this. And let the dry land appear, and it was so. And God called the dry land earth. And he gathered together the waters, in the gathering together the waters called he seas. And God saw that it was good. So again, here we see the Creator, God, Creator God spoke. I want to look at this very particular thing. He spoke the land. He spoke the earth, which included the rocks and the mountains. And that's important to remember. He spoke these things into existence. I want to see it another way, as we saw it again Sunday in John chapter 1. And it's very important to get what we're going to see here. In verse 1, it says this. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. We saw that. We saw the importance of understanding that Jesus is God. The same was in the beginning with God. Here it is. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. If we skip down to verse 10, listen to what it says. He was in the world, and the world was made by him. We saw that he made the heavens and the earth. We saw that he spoke and the dry land was formed. That earth, the rocks, everything in it was formed by his words. And again, it says in John chapter 1, verse 10, that he was in this world, that he spoke into existence. He was walking on the ground, that he himself spoke into existence. Again, he was here. Now I want to see the account of him being introduced into the world in the flesh. We know in the beginning he created with his words. We know that he spoke the land. We know that, again, John chapter 1 said that he was in the world, and the world was made by him. But I want you to have this in mind when we read Luke chapter 2. God, again, made the earth. He made the rocks. He made the mountains where there would be caves, where there would be cut out places for animals. He made those things by his words. Now look at Luke chapter 2. Many people know this. It's read at Christmas time, in most Christian homes, Christian churches, of course. But it says this in verse 1, and it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, everyone to his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David. He was there, he was doing that to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. Verse 7, listen. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. So yeah, we know that's a Christmas story. The story of Mary giving birth to the baby Jesus. We know that it was spoken to her by the angel, that you're to call his name Jesus. He's Emmanuel, God with us. We know the Christmas story. But think about those words again. She brought forth her firstborn son, Jesus, God incarnate, was brought into this world that he spoke into existence, and they took this child and laid him in a manger. The God that breathed out the stars, that Psalms 33 says, God, that spoke in the dry land formed. God, that formed man from that dust, that earth. Breathed into man's nostrils, and man became a living soul. He humbled himself, and deity, again, we saw this Sunday, was clothed in human flesh that he created. But what I want to look at tonight is this. He not only was deity clothed in flesh that he created, but he was also humbly laid in a feeding stall for livestock. Probably a cave-like area with hewn-out stones for animals to eat out of in the earth. Think about that. He spoke, and the ground, the mountains, the land, the rocks, all of it was formed. And yet when he came into this world, Mary laid him in the very rock that he, thousands of years before, spoke into existence. That's phenomenal. That's profound. That God Almighty, Creator God, who can say, let the land appear, and it appeared out of nothing. Now as he comes as Emmanuel, God with us, he's laid in that very rock that his mouth, his words formed. If we look again in John chapter 1, down in verse 14, it says, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And listen, I love this. I love this parenthesis here. And we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So there he lay. There Jesus lay in this feeding trough, in this feeding stall, in this livestock stall, in this part of the earth that he spoke into existence, the glory of God laid in the stone, wrapped in rags, but clothed in the flesh, again, that he spoke into existence. He laid there in a stall, but he laid there willingly in that earthly stone that his words formed. If we fast forward a little over 30 years, he's there. He's speaking with his disciples. Again, he gave life to these men as well. But God incarnate as a grown man is there speaking with his disciples in a city of Sychar. And these men, his followers, are compelling him to eat. And listen to his response in John chapter 4. Beginning in verse 31, it says this, in the meantime, all his disciples prayed him, saying, Master, eat. But he said unto them, I have meat to eat that you know not of. Therefore said the disciples one to another, hath any man brought him aught to eat? And Jesus saith unto them, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. A little after he tells them this, across the Sea of Galilee and Tiberias, he feeds a multitude with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes. The disciples then get in a boat and begin to cross the Sea of Galilee again to head to Capernaum, and he walks on water and calms the sea with his words again. And there in Capernaum, the people ask him how he got there. We saw your disciples get in the ship, but how are you here? Again, God incarnate has walked on water, calmed the seas, fed the 5,000, has done all these things. And here in John chapter 6, we see his response to this puzzle that they can't figure out. John 6, verse 26, it said, Jesus answered to them, verily, verily, truly, truly, I say unto you, you seek me not because you saw the miracles, but because you did eat of the loaves and you were filled. Labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for that meat which endureth unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you. For him hath God the Father sealed. Then they said unto him, what shall we do that we might work the works of God? Jesus answered and said unto them, this is the work of God, that you believe on him whom he hath sent. They said therefore unto him, what sign showest thou then, that we may see and believe thee? What doest thou work? Our fathers did eat manna in the desert, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. And Jesus said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, Moses gave you not that bread from heaven, but my Father giveth you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he which cometh down from heaven and giveth life unto the world. I want to read that again. The bread of God is he which cometh down from heaven, listen, and giveth life unto the world. Profound thoughts. And they said unto him, Lord, evermore give us this bread. And Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger. And he that believeth on me shall never thirst. But I said unto you, that ye also have seen me and believe not. All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. For I came down from heaven not to do my own will. Remember John chapter 4, he said, his meat is to do the will of the Father and to finish his work. I came not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me. And this is the Father's will which hath sent me, that of all which he hath given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again at that last day. And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I'll raise him up at that last day. And then the Jews murmured at him because he said, I'm the bread which came down from heaven. And they said, is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How is it then that he saith, I came down from heaven? Jesus therefore answered and said unto them, murmur not among yourselves. No man can come to me except the Father which hath sent me draw him, and I'll raise him up at the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they shall be all taught of God. Every man therefore that hath heard and hath learned of the Father cometh unto me. Not that any man hath seen the Father save he which is of God. He hath seen the Father. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me hath everlasting life. Listen to verse 48. I am that bread of life. Listen as he explains the rest. Your fathers did eat manna in the wilderness and are dead. He's talking about himself. This is the bread which cometh down from heaven, that a man may eat thereof and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. I want to read that again. The bread that I will give is my flesh. Listen to this profound statement. Which I will give for the life of the world. That's phenomenal. Again, Creator God saying, let there be land. Let there be water. The waters come together and they're going to be called the seas. And the land, it's going to be called the earth and the mountains and the rocks. And he came. And he was laid in that trough, that manger, that he spoke into existence. And now in his earthly ministry, he's talking to these people, these Jews, and he's trying to explain to them, I'm everything you've ever needed. I'm the bread of life. The Jews therefore strove among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? We're not cannibals. How can we eat this man's flesh? How is he going to give us his flesh to eat? And Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoso eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath eternal life. And I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him. As the living Father hath sent me, and I live by the Father, so he that eateth me, even he shall live by me. This is that bread which came down from heaven. Not as your fathers did eat manna, he said, and are dead. He that eateth of this bread shall live forever. Christ was teaching these unbelievers. His disciples were there too, but he was teaching these people who were unbelievers hard things to hear and hard things to understand. And so what is he talking about? Eating his flesh and drinking his blood? I don't understand that, Brother Kyle. In summary, he was teaching them who he was. He was teaching them not only that, but what he was here to do. He was teaching them the importance of what him giving his life truly meant. How important it really was. He was giving his life as the bread of life as a ransom. And him speaking about his broken body, his flesh, and speaking about his blood were very clear representations of the physical death that he would experience in that body. Very clear teaching that his body would be put to death for their sakes and for ours. And he was teaching them, unless a person wholly accepts, wholly receives who he is and what he did on the cross, unless a person wholly believes who he is and believes what he's done, they can't have eternal life. But he was also teaching them that all who do wholly accept and wholly embrace him, the person and the work, will have life and life eternal. A couple years later, before he experienced that death, his ministry went on. But as it was about to come to a close, he sat down with his disciples. And he brought all of this, the manna, the Exodus, the Passover, the bread, the broken body, the shed blood. He brought it all full circle for those who were following him at the Passover feast. We call it the Last Supper. We call it the Lord's Supper. And I want to remind us, Scripture tells us that he is our Passover. But he was about to explain, or try to explain that to his disciples there in that upper room. He was going to try to explain that everything from the beginning of it all is all about him. It's all about him. Again, he brought to light that Passover that they had celebrated every generation since the Exodus was all about him. In Luke chapter 22, verse 7, it says this: Then came the day of unleavened bread, when the Passover must be killed. And he sent Peter and John, saying, Go and prepare us the Passover, that we may eat. And they said unto him, Where wilt thou that we prepare? And he said unto them, Behold, when you enter into the city, there shall a man meet you, bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house where he entereth in. And you shall say unto the goodman of the house, The master saith unto thee, Where is the guest chamber, where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples? And he shall show you a large upper room furnished, and there make ready. They went and found as he had said unto them, and they made ready the Passover. When the hour was come, he sat down, and the 12 apostles with him. And he said unto them with desire. And that's a message in itself. But when I read these words, I have to try to compose myself, because here was God in the flesh, having instituted the Passover, having provided in the wilderness. Again, all pointing to Jesus Christ. All of it was pointed. The temple, the tabernacle, all of it points to Jesus Christ. And from the beginning of man's fall, here comes the reconciliation. He's sitting down with them in this upper room. And God in the flesh pours his heart out with desire. I have desire to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. That's amazing. The God of all creation, the God who clothed himself in human flesh that he created, that was willing to be laid in a stone stable, in a feeding trough that he spoke into existence. And he ministered, and he tried to point men his own, and his own received him not, as he was on this earth. And now he's sitting here before he's about to die, and he's sitting here with his followers, and he shares with them, this is what it's all about. It's full circle. With desire, I have desire to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say unto you, I will not any more eat thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took the cup, and he gave thanks, and said, Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come. And he took bread, and he gave thanks, and he brake it, and gave unto them, saying, This is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, This cup is the New Testament, my blood, which is shed for you. See, back in Capernaum, when he was trying to tell that crowd, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you can't have eternal life. He was now making it very real in a tangible, in a visible, in a way that they could experience it here at the Passover. This bread, it represents my body. This juice represents my blood. And as they sat there, and after from generation to generation, knowing what the Passover meant, I believe those disciples began to maybe put some of those dots and connect them. Emmanuel, 30-something years ago, God humbled himself, and he clothed himself in flesh for this moment to be our Passover. Again, everything from the time that God began to tell man what they needed to do pointed to this moment. God incarnate, come to this earth to reconcile mankind to himself. Tonight, for this Christmas season, we're going to observe the Lord's Supper in remembrance of him. What a greater way to remember Emmanuel, God incarnate. Because when we observe this supper, we are showing his death until he comes again. The death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We are remembering that broken body and that shed blood tonight. And so I urge you, as we consider again this Christmas season, I pray that you take this moment to really meditate on what God has done. He spoke that rock into existence, that he would willingly be laid in as a baby. That flesh would develop over 30 years to become broken flesh and poured out blood for our redemption. And we observe that tonight. We know that the bread is just a symbol. We know that the juice is just a symbol. There's nothing spiritual in this bread. There's nothing spiritual in this juice. It doesn't change form. It doesn't change substance. It's a representation of what our Lord has done for us. And so we do that tonight in remembrance of him.